Okay. Right. A very warm welcome this morning to Father's Day service. Now, before all you who are not fathers, obviously, done, switch off, it's actually a service that is applicable to everyone, because what we're going to talk about are principles that are good for daily living, but particularly going to focus on this day, on Father's Day. So I looked up the tradition of Father's Day, because it hasn't got such a long tradition, you'd think, as Mother's Day. But actually, it has. And I found this on Wikipedia. Father's Day is a holiday on honouring fatherhood and paternal bonds, as well as the influence of fathers in society. In Catholic countries in Europe, it has been celebrated on the 19th of March as St. Joseph's Day since the Middle Ages. And in the United States, this is where it comes to us, the United States, Father's Day was founded by Simona Smart Dodd and celebrated on the third Sunday of June, the first time in 1910. The day is held on various states across the world, and different regions maintain their own traditions of honouring Father's Day. And I found out a bit more about this. It came out of a tragedy. There was a tragedy in a mining accident in America, and I think it was 22 fathers and men lost their lives. And thought, really, there's nothing to celebrate their achievements. So that's when it came into being in this way. I'm afraid it's got a bit commercial, as all these things. But everyone should learn from these things, and everyone should be thankful for a Heavenly Father. We're going to think about that as well. But what we're going to think about later is the principles of the Bible and how we should live our lives, and particularly for fathers. It's a real perfection guide, so don't expect every one of us to achieve this, but it'd be good to aim for this. So this is what we're going to talk about this morning. But first of all, we're going to start with a really good hymn, which is How Great Is Your Faithfulness. They've got a father theme through all these hymns, hopefully, or most of them anyway. And it's good to see Dave back.
Changes all turns, unfailing justice, unfading grace, whose promises remain. Yes, your promises remain. Now unto the King who reigns over all and never changes all turns, unfailing justice, unfading grace, whose promises remain. Yes, your promises remain. The heavens rain, the saints all sing. Great is your faithfulness. From age to age, we will proclaim. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness.
faithful Heavenly Father. And He is indeed. And we're going to do a short reading now, which is Psalm 128. This ties into what we're going to think of later. And it's a song of ascent. And what that is they used to sing these songs, excuse me, as they marched up to the temple. So you can imagine singing with joy and singing with, probably with musical instruments, going up to the temple. So it's a joyful song. And it's a very short one, it's only six verses, so it's Psalm 128. Blessed are all those who fear the Lord, who walk in obedience to Him. You will eat the fruit of your labour. Blessings and prosperity will be yours. Your wife will be like a fruitful vine within your house. Your children will be like olive shoots around your table. Yes, this will be a blessing for the man who fears the Lord. May the Lord bless you from Zion. May you see the prosperity of Jerusalem all the days of your life. May you live to see your children's children. Peace be on Israel. Well, God has answered that prayer for me. I've seen my children's children, and it is a blessing to see them. And it's a blessing to give them back as well, isn't it? It's a great thing. Well, we are a family here at Chailey, and as a family, we celebrate, don't we? We celebrate various things. And we've got someone in the congregation today. Yes, Richard. Yes. We celebrate you, Richard. Yes. But this week, on Friday, I believe there's a young lady who's got a birthday. Linda. I think 21 again, Linda. So maybe we can... I'm sorry, I've sprung this on David, but we can sing happy birthday to Linda for Friday. We won't ask your age, Linda. Very wise. There we go. Okay, so let's all sing silently. Sing. I don't know how we can do that. Meld it. Come to prayer. Dear God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the memory of our fathers. And Lord, we pray that if these are not nice memories, we thank you that you are our Heavenly Father and that you are always there for us. We thank you for all that our fathers have done for us through the years. And we have a memory of them even if they're not here today. Lord, as I come before you soon to speak from your word, pray that you give me the right words to say. And Lord, as we look at the perfect Father, we know that we cannot, even if we try, match up to you being our perfect Heavenly Father. We thank you that you care for us, that you cuddle us, that you embalm us in your arms, and that you look after us. Lord, your every desire is for us and for our well-being. Thank you, Lord, for your wonderful, loving care. We thank you for the beauty of your creation. We thank you for the rain, and we thank you for the signs of your magnificent creation. We think of the thunderstorm we had, and we look and we marvel at the power that comes from the heavens. We thank you for the multitude of stars in the heavens that we cannot even count, and the sand of the seashore, and everything else that is so numerous within this land. And my Lord, we ask forgiveness that the first thing you asked us to do when we were on this earth was to look after this creation, and we failed you miserably. Forgive us, Lord, but help us to look after the creation you have given us. Help us to be good in the way that we live, and economical and ecological in all that we do. Help us to look after this world. We thank you that there is a consciousness now, especially among the young, that they may do this. Pray that this may grow with all of us, that we may think before we do things. Help us to live in this world in a way that makes this world last longer and healthier. Lord, we do think of the pandemic at the moment. We do pray that the continuing of the vaccinations may fight against the growth in cases, and we do pray that you would keep us safe here in Cheyne. We thank you that you have. Pray that you would help us to be sensible in all we do and say. Help us to be patient. That's something that I really need to learn. Patience that we just wait for the right time. But Lord, I pray that the government, you give them wisdom as well. It's a very difficult time at this time, even local government and national government. Pray that you give them the wisdom to make the right decisions. And Lord, I pray for us as a church and the elders of the church, that you'll give us the right decisions to make, that you'll give us the right way forward, that you'll help us to be patient, but also to go forward. Pray for this as a church. And we thank you that we're a family together. And we thank you that we could celebrate Linda's birthday on Friday. Lord, I pray and thank you for the loving family atmosphere of this church. Help us to be welcoming. Your word says that we are to welcome all. And that a cup of water or bread is as if it's given to you. So help us to remember that. Help us to be kind and considerate and loving as you are. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Then I have another reading, which is James chapter 4. I like James. It's such a practical epistle, isn't it? Letter written to the churches to encourage those who are going through hard times. And it's talking about submitting to God. So James is here speaking about troubles in the church, if you like. What causes fights and quarrels among you? Don't you come from your desires that battle within you? You desire, but do not have. So you kill, you covet, but you cannot get what you want. So you quarrel and fight. You do not have, because you do not ask God. When you ask, you do not receive, because you ask with the wrong motives. Got it all wrong there, haven't he? But it's a bit like us sometimes. That you may spend what you get on your pleasures. You adulterous people, don't you know that friendships with the world means an enmity against God? Therefore, anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God. Or do you think Scripture says without reason that he jealously longs for the Spirit he has caused to dwell in us? But he gives us more grace. That is why Scripture says, God opposes the proud and shows favour to the humble. Submit yourself then to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Come near to God and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Grieve, mourn, and wail. Change your laughter to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourself before the Lord, and he will lift you up. Brothers and sisters, do not slander one another. Anyone who speaks against a brother or sister or judges them speaks against the law and judges it. When you judge the law, you are not keeping it, but sitting in judgment of it. There is only one lawgiver and judge, the one who is able to save and destroy. But you, who are you to judge your neighbour? Now listen, you were saying, today or tomorrow we'll go to this or that city, spend a year there carrying on business and make money. Why do you not even know what will happen tomorrow? What is your life? You are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. Instead, you ought to say, if it is the Lord's will, we will live and do this or that. As it is, you boast in your arrogant schemes. All such boasting is evil. If anyone then knows the good that they ought to do and doesn't do it, it is a sin for them. Very wise words, doesn't it? And I think at some time we will look through James again because it's such a wisdom-filled letter and plenty of practical advice. We're going to now have another song, How Deep the Father's Love.
Beyond all measure, that he to give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon the cross, I see upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished.
Should I gain from his reward, I cannot give an answer. But this I know with all my heart, his wounds can heal. Yes, thank you. So we're going to talk about Father's Day today. Now, one of my numerous children, got too many to remember. No, I haven't. But Andrew gave me this, which...
Andrew.
Yeah, you, Andrew, you gave me this. With a box of chocolates as well, says the world's best dad. He did. And it says provides great advice, always encouraging and protective, gives unconditionally, believes that you can achieve anything, and shines with pride when you succeed. Makes you laugh. Well, I think we do. Makes Richard laugh anyway. Can fix anything. Tells dad jokes. Well, that's true. And owns a free taxi, that's true too. There to catch you if you fall. Well, I didn't catch him yesterday, he fell over and hurt himself. Any man can be a father, but it takes someone special to be a dad. That's very sweet, and I promised Jan I wouldn't cry, so that was the condition to bring this here today. She said, you're not bringing it if you cry. So I didn't. Sorry? There is a lot of light on that. But if we were to live up to that, we'd be wonderful fathers. But I don't think I can live all up to all that. But what we're going to look at from Scripture is what a good father is about from Scripture. And we're going to do it with an acrostic, which is, I think that's right, Susanna, I'm very bad at acrostic, yes? Which is fathers. So we're going to look at each letter in turn, but it's very short. So the first one is F. Fun to be with. And Ephesians 6:4 says this: fathers, do not do not annoy your children. Instead, bring them up in the training and instruction of the Lord. Or Colossians 3:21, fathers, do not embitter your children or they will become discouraged. I think some children want their fathers to leave because they're always angry or they're in a bad grumpy mood and they want their father to go to work. So being a good father requires patience with children and having fun. But it's to be a big factor on how children perceive God, isn't it? If they all say, go away, I'm busy, can't have fun with you, I can't play with you, that would perceive, go on to say, well, you know, they're talking about Christian love, they're talking about being good Christians, and there they can't even join in with the fun. We need to have more fathers that enjoy their children, and in return their children enjoy their fathers. We don't take time to enjoy them. If we don't take time to enjoy them, we will regret it, and that's fathers, mothers, anything, as we grow up. And I remember a little story of my own father. My poor father was always ill. He lived on a farm, and from an early age they drank milk from unpastured cows, and he got undetected TB, so half his lung was taken away. So he was always in hospital, he was always ill, and he couldn't play with us as he would like to. And my mum used to have a little shop, and she was always busy, so it was always, go and play. So they were loving parents, but I remember one holiday we went on, one of the rare holidays, when he was feeling better. He was playing on the sands, and I saw him crying. I said, what's the matter? He said, I wish I could play football with you more, but I can't because of my health. And it struck me later in life that my dad was a good man, he prayed for us. He did all he could for us, but he regretted he couldn't play with us because that was not part of what he could do with his health. And we will regret if we avoid all the fun that we have with our children. I think that is true. So that's the first one. F is fun to be with. Second is affectionate. Romans 12:10 says, be devoted to one another in love, honour one another above ourselves. This is what I said about earlier, about it being for everyone. This is particularly for fathers we're thinking, but everyone should be affectionate to each other. The word devoted literally means to nourish tenderly. Isn't that beautiful? To nourish tenderly. And we should do that for our children, should we not? They should be objects of our tender, affectionate care. If as fathers we need any time more in the lives of their children, it's to show them sincere, heartfelt affection. We want to be able to come up and feel that we can cuddle their parents, can't we? And if we're not being pushed away, fathers need to show affection in every part of their life for the children. That means to laugh and to cry with them. I read somewhere that there's nothing wrong with being manly, but Jesus wept. Jesus showed affection. And he was the strongest man that ever was. And he loved children, didn't he? He loved children. He showed affection. Suffer not the children to come to me. But his disciples were saying, you're too busy, you're too important. The children were coming up, rushing to him. He was telling them stories, I'm sure. And the disciples were saying, go away, children. Because in that society, children were seen and not heard. That's a saying that my mum and dad used to say. Children should be seen and not heard. But, you know, it was like, get away. And he said, no, let them come to me. For such are the kingdom of heaven. You need to be childlike. So you need to have time for children. You need to have that affection. But the third thing is we need to train our children. Proverbs 22:6 says, start children off on the way they should go, and even when they're old, they will not turn from it. And that's true. That is true in my case, I remember. My mum and dad were good, godly parents, and they used to sit me down and tell me Bible stories. They used to send me to Sunday school. And at the time, I didn't thank them often enough, I don't think. I used to find it a bit boring. But when I go back now and think about what happened before, that's the heritage that they gave me. And their prayers came true when I became a Christian. And that's what we need to do. We need to train our children in many ways. Father, are to be spiritual leaders and mothers as well in the home. Children training contains three things, I believe, that the father must include. That is dedication. Psalm 127:3, we read that earlier. Children are a heritage from the Lord, an offspring, a reward from him. A heritage. Not a chore, but a gift. Heritage is a gift. You inherit something, don't you? A reward from God. They can become, feel a bit of a chore at times, can't they? But no, that's what the wrong attitude really. We need to say that they are a reward from God. Okay, they can be a bit of a pain at times, I understand that. But actually, way back, but, and think back, that children are a reward from God. And we need to dedicate our children to the Lord and thank him for them. That leads us to the second thing, which is instruction. Proverbs 1:8 says this, "Listen, my son, to your father's instruction, and do not forsake your mother's teaching." It's something that can lay down the principles of life, isn't it? If your father and mother teach you good habits, then you're more likely to continue with them. Not completely sure that you will, but if you're given good manners, you'll go through to give good manners to your children. Instruction particularly on how to please God, which leads to the third thing, isn't it? Discipline. Proverbs 13:24. "Whoever spares the rod hates their child, but the one who loves the children is careful to discipline them." Of course, discipline is not, it's to be a fair discipline. It's not violent. And that's the sadness, isn't it? There's this violence. And even in the past, it was attributed to this verse. And it's not that. It's not that at all. That's terrible. It's taken out of context. It's the love that disciplines a child so they're not spoiled. Hands up anyone who likes a spoiled child. No, nobody likes a spoiled child. And we've seen them all at times. And probably, possibly, I have been in the past and maybe you have. Nobody likes that, do they? A spoiled brat that is there having a tantrum. Nobody will like you. You must be firm and lovingly train them. In Proverbs 29:17, it says, "Discipline your children and they will give you peace. They will bring you the delights you desire." So it's a careful discipline. It's not a violent discipline. It's a care for them because you want them to get on in life. You want them to be good people. You want to be proud of them, like that cut was saying. You want them to be proud of you, and you want to be proud of them. And you can look at them and you can say, "That's what I brought up," and you can have some pride in them. And that discipline is part of it. So that's the third thing. But the fourth thing is humility. Proverbs 16:8 is, "Pride goes before destruction, haughty spirit before a fall." Now, haughty spirit means you're looking down on others. It's like the Pharisees in the Bible. "I'm far better than this sinner over here, this publican. He goes off and he cheats people, and he's in, you know, he's drinking and he's all sorts of things that I'm not." That haughty spirit. But we're told not to be like that, not to be above people. "But by the grace of God go I," it should be our response if we see someone in the street. But often it's not, is it? Well, look at that, despicable. But that's what we need to do. We need to show humility. The opposite is the case often, isn't it? Fathers must allow their children to see them fail and admit it. That's part of it as well. Do you know what? The one thing Satan loves above all else is to bring down mankind through pride. It's his greatest weapon. Satan used pride to start with in the Garden of Eden. Do you remember as he came and tempted Eve to eat of that fruit? Did God really say that? Actually, what he's saying here is, "You're far better than that. You're far better than that. God is mistreating you. He's doing you a disservice by saying you can't eat of this tree, because he knows that when you eat, then you'll see good and evil." He knew that, and he tempted the woman with that pride of being God and themselves. And they fell, didn't they? We need more fathers who will model humility. in their own lives, and it will, which will give us a good example to our children, that fathers and mothers that show humility. When we're wrong, we must say we're wrong. We're not always right. I mean, my wife is right 99.9%. She told me to say that. But you know, sometimes we're wrong, aren't we? Sometimes we're wrong, and we need to say to our children, I'm sorry, I was wrong. But this is the opposite side of the discipline. We need to be humble before our children. But fifthly, we need to be encouragers. Fathers need to be encouragers. There's a person in the Bible called Barnabas, son of encouragement. Now I'm reading this book, which is 1 year praying through the Bible, and it's written by Cherry Fuller. So there's a little bit each day, and I was coming across it last week, actually, on their wedding anniversary on June the 14th, and my wife's birthday. And it says about Barnabas, an encourager. And this is what it says. When Saul, this is Acts 9:26-27, when Saul arrived in Jerusalem, he tried to meet with the believers. That's Saul that would become Paul, do you remember? And beforehand, he was persecuting them. So not surprisingly, they didn't want to see him. But they were all afraid of him. Then Barnabas brought him to the apostles and told them how Saul had seen the Lord on the way to Damascus. Barnabas also told them what the Lord had said to Saul and how he boldly preached in the name of Jesus in Damascus. Barnabas, this is what she said, and I think it's very good. I really recommend this book. It's really good. It goes through the whole Bible in a year. And in fact, it goes through the Psalms twice, I believe. But also it gives a little bit each day, a little reading for you to consider. It says here, Barnabas had the God-given ability to see and understand what the Lord was doing around him. Just as Joshua and Caleb saw the potential in the land of God that promised to give to his people, Barnabas saw that with spiritual eyes something of God's potential in Saul, a former enemy who had zealously persecuted believers before he had met Christ on the road to Damascus. When the other believers feared Saul, rejected his ministry, and pointed his fingers at him, Barnabas spoke up in Saul's defense and declared that God had deposited in him. He continued to be a peacemaker and a bridge between Saul and the apostles, and eventually the believers embraced Saul and welcomed him into their fellowship. Thus God's kingdom will be extended through Judah and the world. Are you like Barnabas, an encourager? And that's a big question, isn't it? We need to be encouragers to our children, but encouragers to one another. If you're willing, you could be just the person God uses to help someone in trouble. You could be the bridge of divine grace in another spiritual journey. That's lovely, isn't it? It's a lovely word. And there's a lovely little prayer that goes with it. Lord, I want to be an encourager like Barnabas. Help me to see others with your eyes. Give me the vision to see the potential you've deposited in them. Fill me with the courage to stand with those who are in trouble and need my help or defense. Make me a bridge of encouragement from your heart and be the heart and to the hearts of others. And it says here, every time we encourage someone, we give them a transfusion of courage. That's lovely. Beautiful, isn't it? So I'd recommend that book. But there we are. Encouragers. Encouraging each other in their failures. Encourage them. Encourage your children to carry on. Give them all the encouragement they need and desire. Don't be hard on them. Encourage them. But the sixth one is to remember. Read the words of Jesus in Matthew 5, again the Sermon on the Mount, verses 33-37. Sermon on the Mount is a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful sermon, and I think we should do a series on the Sermon on the Mount. It's so rich with teaching, isn't it? And as I said before, somebody said, if you took the Sermon on the Mount on one side, and all the books on philosophy and philosophical views, you probably wouldn't need half of those because they're all involved in the Sermon on the Mount. And in verses 33-37 it says here, again you've heard it said to the people long ago, do not break your oath, but fulfill to the Lord the vows you have made. But I tell you, do not swear an oath to all, either by heaven or for it is your throne, or by the earth for it is your footstool, or by Jerusalem for it is the city of the great king. And do not swear by your head or for you cannot make even one hair white or black, or grow even in my case. All you need is to say simply yes or no. Anything beyond this comes from the evil one. That's very solid, wise advice, isn't it? You must say what you mean, and mean what you say. Our children do not forget. And when we do not do the things that we say we're going to do, they become cross at us, and they start to doubt that we are telling the truth. As fathers and mothers and people, we need to remember to say yes as well as no, or not now. It's not always yes, is it? You can't say yes all the time. You have to say no, or not now. But it's important that we give an answer. Somebody wrote here, men are, when it comes to this, are children's natural procrastinators. We say, later, and we forget all about it. We shouldn't do that. God doesn't forget his promises to us, does he? The greatest promise he's given us is the rainbow in the sky. The rainbow in the sky is a sign from God that he won't flood the earth again. We have lots of floods, but he's not going to flood the earth again. And it's a reminder always of God's promises. And he always gives us these promises that he will fulfill. And as our Heavenly Father, he gives us an example to us to give our promises. And we shouldn't promise our children things that we can't deliver. Like we say, we're going to the moon next week. You can't do that. But, you know, things that we can promise to do, we must make an effort to do. There are situations that come unavoidable that you can't do it. But you should make every effort to do what you said you would do. It's important to remember. And then finally, it's sacrifice for our children. 2 Corinthians 12, verses 14 and 15. Paul is talking to the Corinthian churches here. He says here, "Now I am ready to visit you for the third time, and it will not be a burden to you. After all, children should not have to save up for their parents, but parents for their children." It's sad that many parents or fathers have all the wonderful toys in life and their children have nothing. That's sad if you see that, isn't it? Now, I'm not saying that children should have everything they want. I said that before. They become spoiled then, don't they? But a balanced view is that godly fathers should be willing to sacrifice and be a sacrifice for their children. And I know many are. And through this pandemic, we've heard of people, and through the news, through normal times, we hear of people that give up even their food so their children can eat. And that's very sad, and it shouldn't be in this land, but that's a political thing that we need to sort out. But it's something that we give in sacrifice. We give our time. We give our energy. We sacrifice so much for our children, but it's worth it. It's an investment, isn't it? It means in all areas of our lives, in our hobbies, their sports, their time, their money. Don't be too engrossed in the football or whatever it is that you can't spend time with children. I'm talking to myself as much as anyone else. When they say we want to play a game, play time with them, spend with them, sacrifice time. And there are times, we be honest, that we don't feel like playing a game or acting the fool to entertain. Oh, I always enjoy doing that, funny enough. But if you don't, one day you'll be grown up. They'll be grown up and you will regret it, because suddenly they won't want to do that foolish things that you want to do them when they were small. So the conclusion of this sermon this morning is that we should honour our fathers and our grandfathers today. Our fathers are special and they're vitally needed in the home. They are to be the compass and direction giver for the home. And godly father care is all that we should do for them in all these things. So we need to be fun to be with. We need to be affectionate. We need to train our children. That's important. Not just let them go wild. We need to be humble. We need to say, sorry, we've got it wrong. We need to be encouragers. That's good. That's wonderful. Carry on. We need to remember. We must remember the promises we give to our children and go through with them. We must remember to say yes, no, or not at the moment. Just not ignoring them. And above all, We need to be sacrificial in the way that we treat our children. Amen. Let us pray. Thank you for your word. I thank you for the wise words within it. This is a huge list of things as fathers and mothers and as friends that we can do for each other. Lord, we know we will fail in some things, but help us with the power and the help of the Holy Spirit to go forward in attempting to do these things in the power and the help of yourself. Thank you for your word. We thank you that it is a wonderful word that encourages us to do many things. Help us to be good parents, to be good friends for each other. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Going to finish with one of our favourites here, Magnificent Marvellous.
Magnificent, marvellous, matchless love, too vast and astounding to tell. Forever existing in worlds above, now offered and given to all. Oh, fountain of beauty eternal, the Father, the Spirit, the Son, sufficient and endlessly generous, magnificent, marvelous, matchless love. And marvelous, matchless love. How great.